She believes in making children self-reliant with high self-esteem and confidence level from a very young age, a skill and attitude that would make them stronger in their adulthood. Isn't that what all parents wish for their children and all teachers for their students? We want to play a part, you know, in creating opportunities of learning such that they grow into confident adults and enjoy the process through their growing years. What better way to do than dancing and prancing your way through early childhood years, right? Kirtana and her team of teacherpreneurs do it all through dance and movement, including motor development, gymnastics, music and fitness program for young children through online, blended, and of course, traditional classrooms. Hi, I'm Nivedita, and today in conversation with me is Kirtana Ramarapu of Learning Parachute, who has brought Kinder Dance program to India. Welcome, Kirtana, and thanks for your time, for sharing your thoughts with me and my viewers.
Thank you very much, Nivedita ma'am. It's a honor to be here, and welcome to all the audience who are listening to us today.
Thanks. I will start the first thing that has been on my mind since I have been speaking to you. With the raging pandemic and our children quite cooped up in their homes, parents of very young children and also their teachers, we are all concerned about their motor development, social skill development, and of course, childhood obesity, all at the same time, because all our entertainment has centering around food at this point in time. So as an early childhood specialist in the field of movement and dance, what are your thoughts on these three concerns that's very upfront in our minds as educators, as well as parents of very young children?
That's a very interesting question. With so many things not available to parents also, it's very difficult for children to actually work with them, but it's all again creativity on how we can do. One of the simplest thing is, if you remember in our summer camp, during our summer holidays, right up from making a pickle or even to make papad, these are all motor skill development, nothing else.
Right.
And we've never had summer camps going out and doing things. Grandparents, uncles, aunts, cousins together, we used to play small things with, like the stones, tamarind seeds. When we, you know, these are motor skill things, and that is what we always want parents to give the children, what is available at home,
right,
and not depend too much on the outside world. But there are a lot of challenges for children because it's a very competitive world. So that is why school educators, the parents always look to see what more they can add to enhance the child's development. And that is where many of our programs come in. The playway methods, the kinder dance, and many different things come in, because we have done certain studies, a science behind our curriculum, and that helps children to work forward. So simple music with even a handkerchief given to a child and ask them to move in any which way they can exercise right up from head to toe and completely give them what is required within 10 minutes a day. That is all is a prescription.
So how, to tell me more about it, this is intriguing. How would you support the parent? Because parent is the educator at this point in time, or there are very, the young children are doing a couple of hours or a week of interaction with teachers. So what would you tell the parent or the teacher to incorporate in their regular interactions with the children, or a structured interaction for that matter, to bring this all together?
So let me just start with what we did last year.
Yes.
Last year, when we all went into the lockdown time, as a team, pan India as well as the worldwide, we had to come together to come out with a creative way to give the child what is required and also keep that attention span.
Right.
Otherwise, a young child with a 3 year or a 4 year, they like to come and, you know, hit the keyboard and try to see where is the teacher, what is she showing. So they don't have that absorption. So what we did is we first did the prerequisites on what is there at a home, at the house. So every teacher, every educator, what as a team, we went and said, what is there in our houses? What can be used as a prop in kinder dance? Because our props were all in the office and we couldn't send it to the teachers nor the parents. So right up from a ruler, a little pouch, a handkerchief, then a pillow, a chair, a plate, a wooden spoon, even your balan for the chapati acted as a wand. So we use a wand to show a child how to tippy-toe on their toes, okay, and we prop them a little bit with a wand. Mm. So that is colorful and it was available with us as a prop. But then at home, the balan was a prop. And for a 2 to 3 year or 3 to 4 year old, the parents were with us in the class. So the parents could actually help in. So this was a creative way of doing things. And the teachers, so we started also the curriculum with Poda Jumbo Kids Whitefield, whose curriculum we took. And we worked with them to see what is required. So a number, a shape, a color. So we would give them a class related to that particular educational concept, and that way the children were learning kinesthetically and absorbing what a teacher was teaching was just being absorbed during the week. And that, and all we need is just half an hour in a week for that child to absorb kinesthetically.
So you're actually, I know that you have been creating curriculum and have been deliberate curriculum in various schools and colleges. So for early childhood years, you actually look at the curriculum and map the curriculum to dance?
Yes, that is what is our specialty. Exclusively designing the dance and movement curriculum for a particular school. Mainly because one is the absorption of the child and experiential learning is very important. Secondly, when they actually learn the music as well as the dance movements, they become confident about their body. Then when they grow in progress in stages, when they come to like a five-year-old or when they come up to first grade, they get into traditional dancing, traditional sports, educational pursuit. It's easy because the body has given that kind of confidence, esteem levels, and the social skills are developed for them. And that is how we design the curriculum. Of course, we do have our dance and movement in a progressive way. We don't expect a two-year-old to jump with their 2 feet, or 1 foot, like hop on a foot. We can't expect a two-year-old. So these are some of the things that our teachers are trained to understand what needs to be kept in mind. The dancing progression will be as is, based on the age-appropriate manner. But the curriculum, like if it's an ocean animals or if it's baby animals, it could be planets. I mean, different things. So we incorporate and we have a whole database of songs that is designed for the brain development of the child, which is again very important because you don't want to hinder their growth. Right. You only want to foster their growth. So that is very important. So that is why we design, and every school have their own curriculum. So we don't have, it doesn't overlay. And it's across all boards, IB, ICSC, state boards. So we can adapt to any board that is there in the world.
So it intrigues me again. Give me an example of a couple of one or two songs which are very special to kinder dance, and how does it relate to brain development or cognitive development, if I may say.
All right. So one of the simple things is, let's talk about body parts.
Okay.
And children love to be tickled. So the tickle is the stimulation part. So before we actually start the song, we have something called a methodology of teaching the child, how to relate to the child. So we call it the see, say, hear, do methodology and an old new combination. This helps us to reach to the children 100%. Because when you combine all the different senses of a child, then their absorption to learning happens very confidently. So if I say body parts, first thing we'll say is, okay, can we tickle your nose? Can we show how we tickle our nose? And then you say, where are your eyes? Can you put your eyes on or eyelids on the top and look up? Or can you see down? Can you tickle your neck? So different ways. And we'll say, okay, let's play a game. Touch your elbows. So they touch their elbows. Touch your knees. Touch your toes. So we give different body parts. So now they're thinking of that. And then we stimulate them to say, okay, first we're going to tickle our nose and then our elbows. And then we start the song. So every month, we have one skill that the child learns. And the starting of the song is touch the ground and tap your knees. So when we do that every week, the dance builds on itself. The child learns the music, the words that is associated with the song, and the different parts of the body. So there's not just the educational concept, but they're moving and smiling, and our dancer manners help them to understand how their body should be. So very cute little thing. Every class we do our dancer manners to say, we are all beautiful and special people. Can you show a beautiful smile? Mm-hmm. And that's how they point to their lips. And then we say, can we actually, you know, show how a rain falls without even speaking? Mm-hmm. So then we say dancers always and gymnasts always talk with their body and not with their mouths. This is actually like a circle time. Setting the guideline for the class. So we have a way to do it, and then the stimulation and then the dances. So that is the body part. And very similarly, we have something with the fishes and the number. So it's called five little fishes. So then they show five fingers. So the same way, a stimulation and the dance, and the fishes will kind of get into the stream, and there's only one fish, then the second fish joins. So this is about friendship, togetherness. So it's not, again, as you know, there are so many different aspects that we bring into the dancing.
So it's more than a rhyme and dance. It's more than a song or a rhythm and a dance attached. There is more depth to the way the dance and the music or the words have made a combination. How successful it is online? How is it working out online?
It's been quite successful. It is not as successful as a traditional class, but people are adapting, and we are very happy the way the schools are adapting our classes. We've been getting a lot of calls. We're doing a lot of summer camps as well. Parents are liking it. All we need is good internet, because the teachers are trained to be doing online classes from last year. So they have the experience to do it now.
Right.
And we also designed the curriculum in such a way that we have to be very cautious and very, you know, kind of conscious also about the child's eyes, listening, all those different things. So we took out the acrobatics part, because we don't want to hurt the children trying to do something online, because we are not there to assist. So we kind of designed it in such a way that the child looks away from the screen and dances just by listening. Only the first, yes, we had to be very careful on certain things, because that is the biggest concern. We don't want children to be stuck to the TV. So we have a little GIF that comes in between our dances, like a clap or something. So they get to see that. And then there is a little GIF which tells them what's the next song. So if they see the five little fishes, they are ready with the prop that they require. And we also get the parents to place the props in different places of the room, so the child can look around, so the eye is not stuck to the screen. So these are little things that we had to put together to be able to nurture the child in every which way we can.
But this actually sounds wonderful. So are you training parents to do it, or training educators to do it, or Are you running training programs alongside for parents and educators?
We are not doing anything like a training for the parents, though it's a great idea to do, because we're given another probably few more months or year, another year for the children to get out.
Yes.
It's probably a great idea, because parents will have something to work with, and it's just 10 minutes a day.
Right.
But we are associating with schools to do this, and our teachers run the classes. Or we train the school teachers to do it themselves. But we overlook the academic progress, and we also look at how the dances are going. because they should be early childhood specialists for this.
Right. Because the way current situation is, and we can hope that it will improve, and we hoped it last year as well. But for the youngest of the children, it will still take some time for the parents to let go the children into a school environment. But education can't stop, learning can't stop, development won't stop. And this could be a good way of putting together and combination of learning through movement, learning through music, and more importantly, both the parent and child having fun about it. So,
yes,
which is great, a big aspect of today's, mental health situation, of the parent and child enjoying themselves with this and with an expert guidance. I think that makes good sense. As an educator, to me, it makes good sense. So I was wondering, very limited opportunities of attending formal schooling currently the young children have. It's a limited opportunity. So if you would say that the parents should look out for limited screen opportunities, more kinesthetic opportunities, what would you guide? What would be your tip to the parent? Because it's a very nervous parent. You know, the parent of a young child is a very nervous parent. They're nervous not only about their own situation, their own work situation, their own future, but also that they are not able to provide the best for their child and at this point in time. So what would be some of your tips to the parents?
Yes, actually, it's quite, kind of scary to see, how much access the children have to laptops and phones and, and especially in today's world where both parents have to work, given the cost of living and everything, nothing to blame them, but that's the only way that they are able to entertain the child. But, and also there's a lot of push from a lot of educators trying to do this to say, give them very limited time on the screen, but also for a parent, it's very frustrating to do it 24/7. But they should set a routine, a good routine, in the sense as if they're going to a school. So they should set up a space, every day. So the day they are with the school, it's absolutely fine because the teacher is there to guide them. But the other days when they don't have class or a school, they should play like a tea time, where the children play with teacups, and then they should have a playtime with Play-Doh. So they should set like a timetable printed in front of them. A child sets a routine. Just because they don't have school doesn't mean the children can sleep late. They should set the sleeping time at 8 every day. Brain development is so important. When they sleep well, they automatically develop. So they wake up fresh, and that itself is a good sign to say the brain is developing very well. So they should set a routine irrespective. And weekend, when they really do something outside, they should probably have a playtime, a sand time or something like that, because a lot of communities they have to schedule themselves to take the child out just outside the house. And or in an apartment complex, come down for a small time when there's not very many people. So they have to keep their precautions. But this is a very important routine. And all they need, again, like I said, it's only 10 minutes. Even if they're going to jump 5 times, is more than enough. Or get them to fold a handkerchief or a bed sheet, put a pillow cover. Every day, just one small activity, I think they'll do wonders. And that is the education we look at a young age, is an experiential one. Right. Numbers, shapes, colors, everything will come through. Yeah. Once, if you get them ready. See, today the parents should look also to say, how am I getting the child ready when the school reopens to be with the other children? That is more important. That's the most scarier part, because children probably already are. I know a lot of my, nieces and nephews whose kids are ready to, already saying, I don't want to go to school. I like this routine. I want online it's actually scary because they don't want to step out. Mm-hmm. And as adults, we also, to go out now, we are thinking so many, you know, ways. We're getting lazy. We're doing so a certain routine, and it will help the child go through a lot. Reduce screen time as much as possible. Give them certain activities, because all these, even your, you know, chapati thing, if you don't have Play-Doh, your atta is good enough. Ask them to knead it and put some color in it. They can do so many different things. So, and there's no dearth. If you go to Pinterest, you get onto Google, you'll see so many do-it-yourself activities. Yes. And if a parent can do a Sunday evening 15 minutes to sit down and say what my child wants to do next week, I think we are set for life.
Oh, absolutely. That sounds very, very hopeful. So setting a routine, sorting out some activities, interspersed with some social interactions, and usual household activities should do good. So I think what I hear from you is giving more importance or enjoying the routine activities would be as helpful or more, even more helpful at this point in time than interacting or learning on the literacy and the numeracy, focusing only on literacy and numeracy at this age.
Yes, absolutely.
And absolutely. It can couple with some dance, why not?
Why not?
Kirtana, you have, sure, go ahead.
A small thing when you said numeracy is, you know, when we put the kolam outside the house, you know, South Indians do that. That is numbers. You can do odd and even numbers with that.
Right.
So for a fifth grader, you try doing that. Art comes through. Your motor skills develop. And the child starts to count. That's a very simple way to count.
And how joyful. We have kolams are done daily. There are kolams for festivals. And it's textural. And of course, there's a lot of fine motor. And of course, it's so pleasing to the eye. It's something at the end of it. It's a project.
Yes.
Oh, wonderful. So I was looking at your varied life. I think one's persona gets built up with the kind of exposures one has, and you have lived in continents. You've lived in Africa, India, US. What aspects of all of this have influenced your thoughts and your approach in what you do today?
We come from a family of educators, whole family, right up from my great-grandfather to all my cousins. And all of us have been, my mother used to have a school in Africa. I used to help her with summer classes. And whenever I go, I used to teach the small children. So that is probably where that little thing seeded. And my dad was the initial stimulator to say, oh, you don't dance? You should learn to dance. This was probably when I was in second or third grade. So I went to a party. He taught me my first steps to Rara Rasputin, Bonnie M song. And I think that is where I started liking and started having a lot of passion towards it. I didn't get any formal arangetram done with the Bharatanatyam, but I have danced, done workshops throughout, right up from Kathak, and now I'm learning Mohiniyattam, currently online classes.
Okay.
I learned ballet, learned, Kuchipudi, Kathak workshops. Whenever I go to Hyderabad, we have a tutor who does 3 weeks workshops. I learn Kathak. So the dance kind of gave me a lot of, I would say, something, outlook to the world was very different. Mm. You know, the music and dance itself, very, very different. I mean, morning when my day starts, it's with the music. Mm. Without the music, it doesn't start. And my feet keep moving. I can't sit. Mm. So that is one part. And in Africa, when I was schooling, when I was doing my high school, I would see, how they can just move different parts of the body individually. I mean, it's like as if they've sliced it and it's compartments and they're just able to move. And I would be fascinated by the way they do it. And I would see their creativity was way too high and skilled. The way they think, the way they were smart, they were intelligent. So I felt everything came through dance. I kind of put dots together to say how dancing can really work. And then, of course, US gave me a lot more because I worked in the IT sector. So customer service, how important it is to openly speak, communicate, success comes from that communication, open communication. So these are all the things put together. I was an entrepreneur since my college days. I had a boutique, so I had, flair for colors. And wow. So everything actually goes. And then I was a distributor for the toys, the Disney toys for Andhra Pradesh. That time it was just one state. So I was a distributor of the network, and business just came, not that we come from a family of business, but learned the hard way. Mm-hmm. And it miraculously came when dance and movement, education, children came together. And I said, wow, this is something which is given to me in a platter and I should make sure every child gets it. And that is my goal, Nivedita. No child should be left behind. We want every child to experience a dance and movement in their young age for a greater adulthood. And we have also developed an app now so that we can reach to any tier. So schools can onboard themselves onto the app and they can take the class. They also can choose which curriculum they want, ICSE or IB. Then they can choose the themes they want based on their, so the lesson plans get drawn out.
Okay.
And then the dances or videos are put. There is a small teacher training there where the school teacher can be trained, but we still look at the progress of the child. And this is what pandemic has brought us, to become innovative, creative, and see how no child can be left behind from kinder dance.
This is absolutely...
So I don't complain about pandemic.
Yes. What is in our control, what we can do, what we can manage, is something we can focus on, right? And if we can focus on dance and music, I think it sounds very heartening. I'm sure there will be many educators and many, many parents who will be, who can find hope in bringing up their young children, because it has been very stressful for them to figure out how can they do it all themselves. They are the nurturer, they are the provider, they are the educator, it's all in one. But if this kind of assistance, which is a very on-screen, off-screen assistance or guidance that they can get, it sounds very heartening. So I would say amen to that, or tathastu to that, inshallah to that. It is the month of Ramadan. So all the best. And may we sing and dance our ways through this pandemic and learn with our children.
Absolutely. This will be wonderful for children to just adopt. And there's a parent app that's coming up. They can subscribe. There's, AI that we're going to be using to assist the child. So it's not going to be something which is unassisted. And so they will see progress. Children will see, parents will see progress. Educators can see the progress. So we are ready for that.
So I'll give all the description and the links where parents can go to or schools can go to. And we'll all the best for all your plans and your vision of no child left behind.
Thank you very much, Nivedita. Thank you. I'm so honored to be with you today.
My pleasure.